Welcome to Flying the West, a show where we look at pilots, airplanes, where they go, and what they do. One of the more romantic figures of aviation is the Cropduster, a pilot who spends most of his flying day a few feet off the ground, except when he's dodging power lines. Today's duster is a professional who uses all of his skills to put the load in just the right place. Let's take a look at the work these pilots do and learn why they're sometimes called the Farmer's Air Force. Have you ever been driving through farm country and seen a little yellow airplane skimming over the crops and leaving a cloud behind, then pulling up sharply and turning to dive at the field again? Farmers do this aerial application of chemicals to kill insects or plant disease, to fertilize, eliminate weeds, or even to seed new crops. We call this crop dusting. All crops need to be free of insects, diseases, and weeds. If any of these are present, it can mean damage or destruction of an entire crop and disaster for the farmer. In the early days, the field workers would put pesticides on the field by hand. Even with farm animals, they could only cover a few acres a day. In 1921, Ohio State agricultural scientists teamed up with the Army Air Corps to modify a World War I Ginny aircraft to carry a hopper of pesticide. An operator stood in the back seat of the plane and cranked a handle to feed out the powder. The experiment was a great success, one of many for the pilot, Lieutenant John McCready. He went on to be an aviation pioneer, making the first night parachute jump, setting a world altitude record, and being the first pilot to fly completely across the country. Next year, the operation was moved to Louisiana to attack the boll weevil, a major threat to the cotton crop of the South. With innovations in the distribution system and in the flying techniques, planes were able to apply chemicals to hundreds of acres a day. Seventy years later, crop dusting remains a vital component of agriculture. The aircraft and distribution systems have changed, but the application remains the same. Modern agriculture has prospered because of the use of irrigation systems and mechanized equipment. The airplane, like the tractor, is just another farm implement. Only this one spreads insecticides and fertilizers from the air.
We need aerial application on our farms as a tool for applying insecticides primarily at a very timely response. For instance, if the ground is too wet with irrigation, we can't get a ground rig in, and or if we have a bug problem that happens fast, we can usually have an airplane on the field within 24 hours.
Basically, doing a job for the farmer, because that's what we are, just tractors, you know, a tractor that's flying over the field versus driving across it and, you know, destroying the crop.
It's about farming economically. It's about controlling insects and weeds and the things that farmers can't afford to have around. We're just an agricultural service business.
You know, we have customers and they place orders and they're the ones that plan on us. You know, we're written into their program for helping them fertilize their crops and taking care of pests. And we're kind of an emergency operation at times because if a pest gets in a crop that's destroying it, and sometimes it will, like a late blight in potatoes can take potato crops really quick. And then an airplane is the fastest means to apply the pesticide that will kill the blight.
What kind of airplanes do dusters fly?
It's an AdCat. Out of the late 40s, they started making them. And then in the 50s, they sold to Schweitzer. And no one is making them anymore. They're still good airplanes, but the big ones are starting to rule the roost.
The turbine is the cheaper of the two to fly. It costs quite a bit more to buy it, but as far as operational cost, it's a lot more economical maintenance-wise and fuel burn per work done. The turbine has quite a bit better spray pattern than the round engine, because the round engine just has too much turbulence around the engine. A turbine airplane is pretty much dial-up speed. You can put the power lever wherever you need it to get the desired power. So they not only fly fast real well, but they fly slow real well also. We have three dromedaries, and the dromedary runs pretty close to 1,000 horsepower, and it'll pack around 5,400 pounds. The dromedary is made in Poland. Parts are kind of interesting to try to find. But the engine, the firewall Ford, is the conversion that we've done here, and it's all made in the USA. The agricultural aircraft is basically built for one specific purpose, and that's applying pesticides or fertilizers or seeding. It's not a hot rod, it's not an aerobatic airplane, it's pretty much just a piece of farm equipment. And it does a really a good job, you know, for its intended purpose.
A crop duster's life is certainly not boring.
I started in January of 1966. So this is the 40th year. I haven't had a lot of forced landings. I've only had one complete engine failure that was right on the end of the landing strip. There was nothing to do but land. And the rest of them have all given you some power and some time. The cockpit area is engineered in the neighborhood of 40 Gs, and the body comes apart about 40 Gs. So you can still be tore up in there and they can still find you. But they're very tough. They're built on a progressive disintegration engineering program. They'll start at either end, and the first first box breaks, and then the second one, and then the third one, and it just keeps absorbing energy until it gets to the cockpit area. I know two guys who have crashed AGCATs going vertical into the ground. One of them was a turbine, and the other one was a bigger, the 1340 Pratt & Whitney. They were had their arms and legs broken, but they had no internal damages at all. And both of them went back to flying.
I probably had over 10 dead stick landings by the time I'd say I was 30 years old. And, you know, we were running some round engines that just wasn't doing a very good job. The old radials, some of them are just getting tired. It's just time for them to retire or settle down and fly antique warbirds. As far as the safety considerations, the aircraft that we're flying is really set up to be quite crash-worthy. They actually have wire cutters on the landing gear and up the windshields, and there's a wire deflector that'll kick a power line over the vertical stabilizer. The cockpit has a roll cage built into it, so if you landed upside down, you know, it'd keep it from, well, hopefully keep it from crushing you if you didn't hit the ground too hard. Our planning is what keeps us from hitting any obstructions, so we really train ourselves and try to discipline ourselves to operate the aircraft in a safe manner. We familiarize ourselves with power lines. When we get to a field, if it's a strange field and we've never seen it before, the first thing we'll do is fly around the field and really take a close look at it. You know, spot the trees, the houses, any obstructions, and then we'll make an assessment on the safe way to fly the field. Then we get to the ground aspect too, the people on the ground, we want to keep them safe. When we're flying over the fields, we basically try to maintain a constant airspeed, you know, to keep our calibration correct. If we fly too slow, we create too much of a wingtip vortex. And so the speed, right around 130 miles an hour for this airplane is pretty much optimum. You get any faster than that, and it kind of takes the center out of the spray pattern. When the load goes down, we just reduce power to compensate. And so we pretty much can maintain the same speed throughout the whole job. We fly at different altitudes over the crops. It depends on what we're putting on, you know, and what the crop canopy's like. If we're putting on fertilizer, we typically want some altitude to spread the fertilizer out. So we're applying the fertilizer at about power line height. To the other extreme, with, say, a mature alfalfa field that we're trying to kill bugs in, it has it's hard to get the spray to the bugs, so we'll get the wheels just right on it. We might have our wheels a foot off the crop or even less than that. Well, helicopters versus fixed wing for applying pesticides and fertilizers to crop or is just kind of an economics thing. You know, a helicopter is a really neat toy. Wished I could afford to fly one. You know, but it really, you have to be working on something that you can get more money out of than you can with the fixed wing, because they just cost more to operate. You know, they burn more fuel. They're inefficient. They require a lot more maintenance. They have more life-limited components that, you know, when they're timed out, you know, you just throw it away and buy another one, and those parts are really expensive. So, you know, if I could afford to have one in my operation, I would, just because, you know, what a neat toy.
How do you line up the aircraft for each pass over the field?
I use an automatic Flagman because, I don't know, I've been doing it so long that I get along with it. But they've got GPS guidance systems now that work really within a foot. They're pretty accurate.
Well, our GPS guidance system is one of the best things that's ever happened to the aerial application industry. We actually fly on light bars, and the light bars are usually set out, you know, about halfway down the nose of the airplane to keep your eyes focused out of the cockpit. You know, you want to be able to see what's going on in front of the airplane, what the airplane is approaching, you know, like the ground or power lines or trees, you know, and be able to see those lights at the same time. So you need to be looking in just about the same general area. The two light bars are kind of interesting because one light bar, as the lights diminish toward the center of the light bar, tells you you're getting close to the course. When there's no lights, you're on the line you're supposed to be on. The other light bar is actually, we call it track angle, and it's the angle to that course. And so when you're in a turn between the two light bars, you can see that you're getting close to the line with one light bar, and the other one you can tell how many degrees you are off the intercept. And so if you're bringing them down at the same time, you can make a quick turn right on a course. It's actually takes a lot of practice, and it's not easy to do, and we get real good at it just because we try so hard to master it. You know, if you fly airplanes and you're familiar with instrument approaches, it's like shooting an ILS approach, only you've got to turn onto that thing and capture it within like a quarter mile.
Crop dusting has been a major benefit to the farmer and to the consumer. It increases our farm crop yields and makes us less dependent on foreign products.
Aerial application is about the same cost effectiveness as the ground application. We use it primarily because it's an immediate response to a problem, whereas a ground rig takes time to get in the field. If the field's too wet, we have to wait till it dries out, 2, 3, 4 days, etc. And aerial application also, with certain chemicals, does a better job than ground, whereas ground with certain other chemicals does a better job than aerial. So we use both. We use both forms of application, and they both help each other, so to speak.
Like all farm work, crop dusting is seasonal. Crop duster pilots spray different crops at different times, and sometimes they have to move around just to follow the crops.
Yeah, if you're going to be a crop duster, you know, you just at times to make much money at it, you really have to just move around like a migrant fruit picker.
A big percentage of them move around from season to season. What I'm going to try and do is find somebody who wants to work in July and August before they go to the cotton and after the rice or something. You know, somebody wants to come in and fill a seat for a couple of months.
Chemicals used in the early days of crop dusting, such as lead arsenate, sulfur, and DDT, did a great job of killing insects, but they posed a risk to field workers. Now, federal and state rules regulate the application and make it safer for workers and for consumers.
You know, most of the chemicals we deal with are like insecticides, kills insects. It's a poison that'll kill an insect. You know, and have a hard time, you know, doing much to somebody my size. If a guy did put on a rodenticide, you know, usually you have to eat it for it to affect you.
Well, each chemical has a reentry period after application, so many hours or et cetera, as to when you can go back in the field and do your work, like change water or put a crew in the field or what have you. And our job is to follow those label instructions. The label on all these chemicals has a reentry period that, if it's adhered to, is supposed to be not hazardous at all.
Well, they've tried to engineer most of that out. and also legislate a lot of it out. The cockpits are sealed from the rest of the airplane. We can't load or mix chemicals. We have to have someone else doing that. If you're doing certain things, you have to have so much protective equipment on. And
just what's the value of aerial crop dusting to the farmer?
I think modern agriculture would be behind where it is today if we didn't have aerial application. It offers a very important tool to get chemicals on a field when it's the very optimum time, when the bugs are right to kill.
What I like about being a crop duster is, of course, my love of flying the airplane and then the season. It's really neat to not be doing the same thing all year round. You know, we work hard in the summertime and actually year round, but in the wintertime, you know, we're working inside the shop and I don't have to stay up all night. One of the other things about being an aerial applicator is working with farmers. The farmers are undoubtedly the greatest people on the face of the planet. They're the smartest people around. They do everything if you stop and think about it. You know, they market their crops, they do their books, they fix their equipment, they plant and grow it. They do everything. They're really as independent as anybody.
If you think that flying like this takes a lot of skill to miss the power lines and trees, just think about doing it at night. They do it at night when the air is cool and calm and the pollinating bees are not in the fields.
We have to fly bee hours when there's bees out in the fields, leafcutter bees, honey bees. Most of the insecticides are applied during bee hours. The bee hours are established for the preservation of all the pollinators in our valley, and that's why insecticides are applied during the summer months, during what they call bee hours, which are after dark and before dawn, when the bees come back out and start actively working fields.
Increasing urban sprawl and conversion of farmland to houses is causing many farms to disappear. Yet the growing population will need more and more food. What's the future of farming and crop dusting?
Well, I think it's an important tool that we need and we have to have for the future of agriculture in our valley. And I think that I know it's heavily regulated, and I hope it's not regulated out of business where the applicators can't survive anymore. It would be a blow to our business for sure.
Well, as far as the future of crop dusting goes, you know, my optimistic side, you know, always tells me that that as long as there's farming, there's going to be, you know, crop dusting or aerial application. But right in this local area, we're building houses on prime farmland so fast, and everybody, you know, these days is really content with buying produce that comes from China or, you know, South America or all these other countries. So, you know, in the future, you know, I'm really not sure what's going to go on.
I promised my wife I'd quit when I was 70, and I'm 71 now, and I'm still having fun. So I have to quit before too long, because my rate of my ability to concentrate on and focus on the airplane is kind of going away. I start thinking about other things. So I think time's coming pretty quick.
We've seen that the success of modern crop production is due to the right application of insecticides and fertilizers.
The aerial applicator is actually a partner with the farmer in crop production. So the next time that you're at the dinner table, just stop and think for a minute about the role that the airplane actually plays in the production of the food that you're about ready to eat.
What with the heat, the crosswinds, the stress, and concentration, these pilots do just about as much hard work as those folks down there in the fields. So much for the romantic image of aviators. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to come back again.